All right, continuing on. Now maybe I ought to just go back and introduce this idea of I didn't talk very well about the variables, but again, the variable, we've got system memory. We've got all the little memory cells in system memory. If we've got 4 gigabytes of memory, that's 4 billion bytes, which is 32 billion, 8 bits in a byte, so 32 billion bits. And what we're saying when we say int number of games is go out and reserve 32 of those bits that I'm going to use to store a number. And I've got this integer that I'm calling number of games, so num games. Let's apologize for the writing. Okay. You can see what that says, right? Num games is the address of the place in memory where that information is going to be stored. So when I put a zero in there, then it goes out to that address and makes all of those bits into a zero. And that's what's stored there. When I do a string, I go out and reserve a string of characters. And again, I should look up the size. But it's 8-bit characters, and I don't know how many, 255 of them, let's say. It's going to go out and reserve a big chunk of memory to store ASCII characters, and that's the type. And we're going to call this one user call. You know what I should do? I should apply for a job as, you know, when they have you, like, you're registering for a new website or you're going to buy something or something, it makes you type in a security code. That's kind of what this looks like. Nearly impossible to read stuff. Okay, and what I'm putting in there is a blank. So what goes in there is a blank. There's nothing in there. And that sits out there until I put something in there. And whenever I refer to this word user call now in the program, it will go out to this place in memory and check to see what's in there and put that in place of wherever I use user call. All right, same thing with user throw, CPU throw. Okay, so we get the idea. Okay, so then I said, let's go back to our pseudocode somewhere in here. So let's go now ask the user how many games that they want to play. Okay, so gonna make a little comment here. Get the number of games to play from the user. So system.out.println, how many games do you want to play? Okay, and then we're going to read that in by calling our instance of the scanner that's been built from the blueprint of scanner and say, I want to, so I am going to say in.next. Now, what type of information is it? Because it's going to be a number, I want to read in an integer. So I say go out and get the next int. And where do I want to store that? I want to store it in the number of games. What we're setting goes on the left of the equal sign. What we're putting into it goes on the right of the equal sign. So let's go and put into the number of games in.nextInt. It'll go out to what we type in and store that in the number of games. Okay? All right, so we've got the number of games now. So for that number of games, now I could choose to use a loop here. Well, I'm going to use a loop for sure. I could choose to use a while loop or a for loop or whatever I want to do. Because I know how many games are going to be played, I probably will just use a for loop. So play the game for the number of times the user specified. Okay, so for what? Well, the first part of a for loop is to create a counter. So I'll say I want to create an integer, and a lot of times we'll just call it I. Most of the time we'll just call it I. And I want to say, where do I want that to start? Well, I can start at 1. So this will be game 1. Okay? And then how far do I want to go to? Well, I want to go while I is less than or equal to the number of games that the user has just entered. So if they entered 6, I want to play up to 6. So it'll go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now, a lot of times in programming, we'll instead start at 0. And then rather than going less than or equal to, we'll just say less than, because we started counting at 0. You just kind of get in this mindset in programming of starting at 0. So that's what I was going to do, but maybe it makes more sense to start at 1 and then go while it's less than or equal to the number of games. So we'll start out with game 1, game 2, game 3, game 4, game 5, game 6, if that's what they entered. And then the third part of the for loop is to increment the number of games or the counter each time we come through. We can also decrement if we want to, but most of the time we're incrementing. And then I'll put an opening brace to say this is where the for loop begins, and a closing brace to say this is where the for loop ends, and then I'm going to indent again to show this code is part of the for loop. Okay, so that's a for loop. Now the temptation might be to put the semicolon at the end of the for loop. But if I were to do something like just print system.out.println, which is our print command, and just print hi, now watch what happens. I'll leave it off first, and then I say, how many games do you want to play? Well, let me type in a number like 5, and it should print 5 highs now, because that's what the counter has told it to do. We're going to start at 1, we're going to go to the number of games, and then each time we come through this loop, we want to print out hi. So we get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 highs. If I accidentally put a semicolon at the end of that for loop, or the end of an if statement, or whatever it is, and I say I want to do 5 again, it will print out high one time. Well, why is that? Because with this semicolon, you told Java that's the end of the for loop. That's it right there. And so this statement's just printed just like any other statement. In fact, if I enter 0, how many games do you want to play? 0. It's still going to print high because I said the for loop ends there, and then it just said it prints this like any other old statement with no condition attached to it. So we don't want to put semicolons at the end of for loops or while loops or if statements or switch statements. The only place where we do put it is when we have a do while loop, we'll put a semicolon after the while to show that's the end of the do while loop. So it'll terminate when it's done, when it meets the condition. Okay. Well, we don't want to print out hi. That's not an exciting program. What we want to do is check our pseudocode to say what's next. Okay, well, we're going to ask the user whether they want to pick odd or even. So I say system.out.println, and say, do you want to pick odd or even? Or maybe I'll say something like this. Call it odd or even. Okay, so they're going to call whether it's odd or even, and we're going to read their input in. Now, what kind of input are we reading in? Well, they should be typing the word odd or even, right? And so that goes into the user call variable. So user call equals what? Well, I need to use my instance of the scanner called in, to read in the data. And what type of information is it? Well, it's going to be string information. So I'm going to do a next line to read in that information. I could also use a next. Both of those read in characters. But I like to use a next line to clear out the buffer and read everything in. If they enter more than one word, then it will get all the words. Whereas if you use a next, it will only get the first word. But now we've got that data. The problem is, I'm already picturing it. What if the user types in something besides odd or even? And you can't really underestimate the powers of the user in the crazy things that they'll do. And so I probably ought to make a little check here and check to make sure that what they entered was odd or even. So how do I do that? Well, we've done this a few times in our videos, but we need to check to see. And the initial temptation, it's not a temptation, just the thought is to Say if what the user call entered. Now, first of all, one temptation is to say equals odd. The problem is we're comparing strings, and we can't use the equals equals operator to compare strings. What we want to do instead is use the method dot equals, and then we probably actually want to use equals ignore case, because what if they enter an odd with a lowercase o instead of an uppercase? So I say if the user entered odd, and what we actually want to say is if they didn't enter an odd and they didn't enter an even. We don't want to use an or there, because if they entered an odd, that's not even. And if they entered an even, that's not odd. So it will always not be one or the other. So we want to use an and to say it has to be both not an odd and not an even. So if what they entered wasn't odd and it wasn't even, then we want to tell them system.out.println, sorry, that is not a valid choice. Please try again. Okay, so we send that little message out to them, and then we need to read in their input again. Okay, so we'll say in.next, or sorry, user call equals, see, I just did a double equals there. In.next line with a capital L. And this is to check for valid input. I probably ought to put a comment in there. So if they didn't type an odd and it didn't type an even, then we're going to tell them that's not a valid choice and then try again. The dilemma being, what if they enter invalid input twice? Let's try it. How many games do you want to play? Well, I want to play 5 games. Call it odd or even. And then it actually jumps ahead and says, sorry, that's not a valid choice. Please try again. Well, this is another problem we've talked about. And this is a problem with the buffer having bad input in it. The problem is we have read in an integer. So I entered 5 and then I hit the enter key. Well, it reads out the 5 when I do the next int, but it doesn't read out the enter key. And so when I get here, it goes out to get the next line, and there's already an enter sitting out in the buffer. And so it's just as if the user pressed the enter key. It reads that in and says, oh, sorry, that wasn't valid input, when I never actually even had a chance to type anything. And so before we come into this loop, because we've read in an integer, and before we want to read in the next line, then we need to flush the buffer. And we do that by just doing an in dot next line, not reading it into anywhere. That'll clear out everything that's in the buffer, so that now it'll actually give me a chance to input. I have a clean buffer for my input. I want to play 5 games, call it odd or even, and I say monkey. Sorry, that's not a valid choice. Please try again. If I say monkey again, then it continues on with the program. And that's because I've got an if loop, or an if statement. Well, if I want it to happen more than once, what if they are going to enter bad data? Do I know how many times they're going to enter bad data? The answer is no, and so we use generally a while loop. Anywhere we have an if, we can generally replace it with a while, and now it'll do it for multiple times. So I can say, how many games do you want to play? 5. And I can say monkey. It'll say, sorry, that's not a valid choice. Please try again. Monkey again. Sorry, that's not a valid choice. And it will keep doing it while what they've entered isn't an odd or an even. Okay, so that'll help check for valid input. We'll continue on in this next video. Seacrest out.